Hello, I'm Screffy, and today, in collaboration with FMOD, I'm talking about video game audio in general. Video games give us a unique experience with sound because the environments, events, and behaviors they depict change according to a player's interaction. That means that video games contain adaptive audio, or sounds and music that react and adapt to player input. That's a pretty broad concept, but that's because adaptive audio is deeply rooted in the nature of game audio. Ever since video game hardware could play sound samples, they've been using sounds to evoke places or actions when it's appropriate. Nowadays, it's intuitive that if your character can jump when you press a button, they more than likely jump with some sort of sound, if at least to confirm that the action was completed. But when you're making a game, you don't know exactly when that sound is going to happen. You know it happens when the character jumps, but that could be any time. That's up to whenever the player presses the jump button. This is the most basic level of adaptive audio, getting a sound to play when something happens, rather than at a predefined time. Let's imagine some games in development and apply this basic adaptive audio to them. In the first game, we have a character that can move around an environment by walking when the player inputs a direction. In order to evoke that sense of walking, we'll add some footstep sounds. When exactly should a footstep play? Well, when the character takes a step. We could have the character's walking animation dictate when this footstep sound occurs, right at any moment when their foot hits the ground. It's adaptive because, although it has specific times to play, those times adapt to our player's decision to move. Once we get walking, though, we can start to realize this basic approach has its limits. For instance, this character's footsteps don't distinguish between different types of ground. And in some cases, that's okay. But if different types of ground are important to playing the game, for instance, if ice is slippery, then our adaptive audio isn't doing enough to impart information. Different games present different challenges with implementing sound. In the second game, we have a racetrack and a race car that plays a roaring engine sound while the player is pressing a button to accelerate. Makes sense. But part of this racetrack goes through a tunnel. And while the engine sound evokes our car driving, it doesn't differentiate between outdoors and in the tunnel, taking you out of the immersive experience of playing. Suddenly, you realize that you're not really inside a tunnel. In our third game, we have an adventure where our hero character is going to cross a threshold and see this massive new area of a castle to explore. There's some music that we've implemented at the event of the player crossing the threshold, by sensing when the player is on either side of it. The drawback is, once you cross the threshold, this system cuts off the old music to make way for the new. And that hard cut is very distracting. If there's one thing we don't want to do, it's distract the player's attention from where it ought to be. And last but not least is a little mobile game involving this cat character who collects bells. There's a bell sound effect that adaptively plays at the moment the cat touches the bell, and that sound also represents another point for the player's score. The problem is, that sound gets old fast, especially when you have a lot of bells to collect in succession. So, we have four games, and we've implemented sounds that adapt to the player's decisions. But they're all limited by conditions that are consequences of the player's decisions, such as a character's location. These basic adaptive audio systems can't account for every situation we throw them in. So the solution is to make them more sophisticated. Time for adaptive audio, level 2. In level 2, we can invent systems that not only play a sound when something happens, but change sounds when something changes, even conditions unrelated to the player. Let's head back through our games and plan out more advanced adaptive behaviors for our sound effects. This first game has footstep sounds, but they don't discern between different types of ground. So, let's check what type of ground is under the player character's feet and select from a number of different footstep sounds based on that information. That way, it can seamlessly transition between important sounds without breaking its tie to the action of taking a step. In the second game, we had no sonic contrast between the outdoor and tunnel parts of this racetrack, but we don't even need to add any new sounds to this one. Instead, we can designate the zone of the tunnel to apply an effect to our sound effects. When you enter a tunnel, tunnel reverb gets applied to the audio mix, and when you leave the tunnel, the reverb goes away. It's not a complex system, but it keeps a player more immersed and makes the audio of a racetrack more dynamic, just like the visuals. In the third game, we had an invisible zone that activates a musical transition, but it just jarringly cuts between the two musical tracks. This level 2 adaptive audio will still activate on the event of a player crossing the threshold, but perhaps we can have it cause a gradual change to the music, like fading out the first and fading in the second. With this system, we're on our way to a perfectly sequenced direction of the player's attention. And in the fourth game, our sound effect for collecting bells was just a bit too tiresome when it played the same way every time. There are a couple ways we could add to this behavior. We could randomly vary the pitch of the sound effect a little with every bell, which already adds variety without using any extra sound effects. But who's to say we couldn't add more sound effects, and have this adaptive system choose a sound at random from the list, and a pitch at random every time a bell is collected? Or maybe we could have the bell sound effect always stay in tune with the music track. Perhaps I'm getting a bit ahead of myself. Talking about all these possibilities leads me to the question, is this too ambitious? These level 2 solutions certainly complicate and elongate the technical side of developing game audio, so how would we be able to implement this? How do we bring these adaptive audio systems to life? It turns out there are solutions designed specifically to help developers implement adaptive audio. FMOD is a good example. FMOD provides a purpose-built graphical user interface for implementing and revising adaptive audio. It's similar to a digital audio workstation, allowing sound artists to pick it up quickly. But instead of crafting sounds and music themselves, here you are crafting sound behaviors. You can order sounds not just on a timeline, but to respond to any condition you want. And you can set up how the properties of each sound change, not unlike instructing a band on how to perform your work. Once you integrate FMOD into a game, it performs all these sound behaviors in real time, entirely hands off. With solutions such as FMOD, none of the sound systems we planned out for these four games are beyond our scope. We can integrate them early and test them out. You never know what the game audio will really feel like until you play it. And maybe our initial adaptive audio solution isn't perfect in practice. Maybe the reverb in our racetrack tunnel is too booming. FMOD makes it quick to edit and iterate the system in real time using a feature called Live Update. I can adjust our reverb settings and get immediate feedback in the game itself. That feels much better, and it smoothly takes away the reverb when we leave the tunnel. Excellent. We've gone beyond just creating sounds that adapt directly to the player. We're crafting experiences that give the player information, immerse the player in an environment, direct the player's attention along a narrative, and keep gameplay fresh. We can tune these audio behaviors and hear the change immediately until they sound just how we wish them to sound. Using FMOD, we bridge the sounds we compose with the logic of the game engine. These systems are just the beginning of what FMOD can do. Imagine advancing to adaptive audio level 3 with even more variation or seamless transition between sounds and soundscapes, if you so choose. With FMOD's specialized interface and easy integration, this caliber of game audio is no longer a technical complication, it's a creative challenge. And like any part of game development, conceiving and composing a game audio system is challenging. But seeing it implemented and iterating it to your liking is no longer beyond reach. I'd like to thank Firelight Technologies, the team at FMOD, for helping me construct this video and helping me compose game audio systems. You can learn more about FMOD at fmod.com and discover how your sound and music can adapt. And with that, I'm Scruffy, and thank you very much for watching.